Good morning, dear students.
Good morning, sir.
Hope everybody is doing well.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So, how many methods have we discussed so far? Do you remember?
Three methods.
Three methods. Okay. What are they?
Grammar translation method.
Okay. The first method that we discussed was the grammar translation method. And then?
Direct method.
The direct method. Okay. Good.
And bilingual method.
Okay. Yeah. Very nice. So, today we shall talk about the audiolingual method. Okay, the audiolingual method. Well, if I ask you what does the word audio mean, although the word is very familiar, what does it mean?
Sound.
Audio? Audio, yes.
It means something related to sound or audition.
Something related to sound, okay, audition. That means like where audio visual aids are used. Audio, some where you know like tape recorders are used. So audiolingual method. Well, if I ask you, if you happen to visit a foreign country like China or say Germany or say France, do you think that you will be intelligible to them and you will be understood by them if you are speaking in your mother tongue or say in English? Because English is also not spoken everywhere. Although English has become a lingua franca, still it's not spoken by everybody. Like the people who are not educated cannot communicate in English because it's a foreign language. It's a foreign language for the Germans, it's a foreign language for the Chinese, and it's a foreign language for the Japanese as well. Same as it is for us. Even in India, you know, everybody cannot speak in English. Only the educated ones can speak. Isn't that so?
Yes.
So what is required? Suppose you're visiting a foreign land. And there, people do not understand your mother tongue, and then they do not know English also, some of them, like you come in contact with. For instance, they say you are a paying guest over there, and your landlady doesn't understand the English language. Then how would you communicate in China?
We need to know Chinese for that.
Okay, you need to know Chinese for that. Very nice. So you will have to learn it. So sometimes, you know, when you are visiting a foreign land, it's required that you learn the language of the country, language of the people. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
I'm talking about all this. Why? Because audiolingual method emerged as a teaching method in 1940s. Okay, 1940s. And this method has a historical significance. Since it has a historical significance, that is why, you know, I'm talking about say foreign languages and all. So with the outbreak of World War II, when did the World War II occur?
September 1939.
Very good. And when did it end?
1945.
Very good. It ended in 1945. Very nice. So with the outbreak of World War II, the US officials realized the need for such army personnel who could be trained in foreign languages to do the job of translators and interpreters, okay, and to communicate with the allies and enemies. Because, you know, war was going on, and that is why the English forces were not intelligible to the French forces because almost the entire world was involved. That's why it is called as World War, is it not? So it wasn't a fight between two countries. No. It was a global war, a world war. That is why the forces, the army personnel, the army men were required to learn the foreign language where they were fighting for. Okay, they were supposed to learn the language of the allies and also of the enemies. Who are allies?
Friends,
okay? Allies are friends who are like fighting with you. So the Americans, you know, this was felt by the American officials, I must say. So they wanted their American personnel, they wanted their army men to learn the foreign language. And that is why this audiolingual method was introduced. So to meet this end, some innovations were to be made in already existing teaching methods of English. Like, you know, translation method, as you know, is a classical method. So it already existed. But what happens in the translation method? You have to translate each and every word into your mother tongue to make the students understand. And another method which was very popular and which existed was the direct method. What do we do in the direct method? Yes, tell me.
We explain in English only.
We explain each and everything in the foreign language, in the target language. You cannot use the mother tongue there. Right? Whereas in, okay, you have done bilingual also. It's just a quick revision kind of thing. So, and what do we do in bilingual method?
Both the native and foreign languages used.
Both the native and the foreign languages are used. Okay. Are these languages used by the students?
By the teacher.
Only by the teacher, okay? Only by the teacher. And even the teacher uses them sparingly. I mean, he uses the mother tongue sparingly only. When he has to explain the difficult words into the mother tongue, then only he uses the mother tongue, or else he speaks in English. So, there were some changes to be made in the direct method. Direct method already existed. Now, you know, what do you do in direct method? Direct method is a complete lecture method, you can say. The teacher lectures the way, you know, like, you know, which method I am using at present. I am using the direct method. I am not using any audios, right? But once you watch this an audio or say as a video, then only we call it an audiovisual aid, okay, or audiovisual device. Like, you know, for example, the videos that you watch, what are they called? They are the visual aids. This is how, you know, these days teachers teach. They teach their students through audiovisual aids. But here we are talking about audio, because visual aids weren't that popular in the 1940s. What was popular? Tape recorders were popular. Okay? Tape recorders were there. So, the teachers of the language, they explained things first orally to their learners, and say to make the classes interesting and to make their students understand the right pronunciation, they also made them listen to the audio aids. Audio aids means tape recorders. Is that fine? Earlier we had cassettes and all. I don't know whether you know cassettes or not. We had audio cassettes, we had tape recorders. Okay. Many changes have occurred. The young students might not be aware of. Still, you know, they were used in the 1940s. Okay. So, what was I telling you? Some innovations were to be made in the existing method. Some modifications were to be made in the direct method. So, you know, since this was done for the army men, the army of army personnel, for the army official, that is why we call this method, we call this technique the army method. Okay. Another name for audiolingual method is
army method.
Okay. Why do we call it army method? Because army personnel were trained through this method. Okay. When the method emerged, army personnel were trained through this method, and this, you may say, was the first to be based on linguistic theory and behavioral psychology. Maybe these words are new to you, so I would explain them to you. Behavioral psychology, linguistic theory, you know, because we have done so many linguistic concepts we already discussed. Okay, from about 1947 to 1967, almost 20 years, two decades. From about 1947 to 1967, the audio method was, you may say, the dominant foreign language teaching method in the United States. Okay, the dominant teaching method in the United States in America. The audiolingual method, okay, you know, like you can even call it ALM, audiolingual method. Like GTM is grammar translation method, and BLM is bilingual method, and DM is direct method. So we use these abbreviations. Which method are we discussing? We are discussing ALM. the audiolingual method is akin to the direct method. Why? Because the modifications are made in the direct method. Obviously, it has imbibed things from the direct method which already existed. So, it is related to the direct method. As in it too, I mean the audiolingual method, the students are taught a foreign language directly without using the native language to explain vocabulary or grammar. How is vocabulary and grammar explained? Through the target language. There is no interference of the mother tongue, right? Nevertheless, it is different from the direct method in the sense that it draws on the early 20th century beliefs or say concepts of behaviorism and structuralism. I would write here so that you know behaviorism. Okay, there might be, you know, short notes on behaviorism, and I'm talking about structuralism, structural linguistics. This we have talked about, structuralism. Okay, remember this. So this method, you know, is based on these two theories, structural linguistics and behaviorism. Behavioral theory. This theory was given by Skinner, right? So, behaviorism, as I said, based on Skinner's theory, assumes that a human being can be trained using a system of reinforcement. Okay, system of reinforcement. Remember the word reinforcement. So this theory, behaviorism, is based on what? System of reinforcement. According to this theory, learning a language consists of getting to know its grammar and practicing its rules through different types of drills until habits in the new language are formed and speech becomes spontaneous. You know, like repeated drills are given to students. Like, you know, sentences are repeated, utterances are repeated until they become the habit of students. Okay, until, you know, like they born those structures there in their mind. So if you're repeating same thing over and over again, what does it become? It becomes your habit, and you tend to make less mistakes. So this is what behavioral theory is. Like, you know, this becomes a part of your behavior. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Behavior. The correct behavior receives the positive feedback. You know, like teacher would be asking you something, and if you give a correct response, then you get a positive feedback from the teacher. And incidentally, you know, if your response is not correct, if you happen to give an incorrect response, then what happens? You receive a negative feedback. That's very obvious. What I said? I said that if you are giving a correct response, you receive a positive feedback, and you know when you are getting a positive response from the teacher, positive feedback from the teacher, then that utterance that you said is reinforced in the student's mind. He knows that this sentence is correct, this utterance is correct, and he repeats it over and over again and makes it his habit. And if he happens to give a wrong response and an incorrect response, then he gets a negative feedback. Then what would he do? He would just shun that. You know, here there is no scope of making mistakes. If you happen to make a mistake, if you go wrong, then what would the teacher do? Teacher would stop you there. So, you know, mistakes are, you may say, kind of nip in the bud. Means, you know, before they become the habit, they are just shunned, they are stopped. Is that fine?
Yes, sir.
Because you must have seen, you know, some students, they say that I does not know. And if you do not, like, stop them, well, we do not say I does not know, say I do not know. And you must have seen people saying, some students saying, he do not know English. So it's better that you stop him right there and tell him that he is a singular subject, and that is why we use ES with verb, okay, with the first form of verb. So this should be told right in the beginning. And then he should be given, say, 5-6 sentences and asked to repeat them over and over again until they become a part of his behavior. So is this clear? This behaviorism?
Yes, sir.
Behaviorism emphasizes upon reinforcement. Okay? Reinforcement. It emphasizes upon, say, repeating patterns, structure, or sentences over and over again until they become the part of the behavior, until they become your habit. So this is a kind of habit formation. This is behaviorism. You know, what did I say? Can you tell me one in a line, what does it mean, behaviorism? When something becomes a part of your behavior, okay? When you learn something by heart, when you don't remember, when you don't forget it, when you remember it lifelong, then it is it becomes a part of your behavior. It becomes your habit. So habit forming process, okay? A habit forming process is based on the theory of behaviorism, and this theory was given by B.F. Skinner. I told you, B.F. This is B, okay, B.F. Skinner. Remember the name. Now, this is clear to you. Now, we can have a word on this. Structuralism also. This already, in fact, we have discussed. Structuralism, now you remember when I speak about it. Structuralism, or say, structural linguistics lays emphasis on grammatical structures of a language. Grammatical structures of a language. The structural linguistics is based on the belief that learning a language implies mastering the elements or building blocks of the language and learning the rules by which these elements are combined, from phoneme to morpheme, from morpheme to word, and from word to phrase, and from phrase to sentence. Like you just see, phonemes. How many phonemes are there in the English language? Yes, you have read phonemes, consonants, vowels, diphthong. How many are there? There are 44. Is it not? Then you have morphemes. Phoneme are just simple letters. You know, letters of alphabet are phonemes. And then you have morphemes. Morphemes are bound morphemes and free morphemes. Right? And then you have words, and then you have phrases, okay, phrases, or say clauses, and then you have sentences. And when you combine sentences, then you get paragraph. So this is what, so you know, first you learn, then these are structures, you know. Okay, what are they? They are elements of language. They are structure. They form the structure of the language. So what is structuralism? Like, you know, what forms the structure of the house? You have cement, you have bricks, you have wood, you have glass, so many things. They form the structures of the language. So what was I telling you? Structuralism or structural linguistics lays emphasis on the elements of a sentence. Lays stress on these structures, phonemes, morphemes, words, phrases, and sentences. If you know them, and if you know to combine them to form the sentences, utterances, then you know the language. So this is what. So you may say audiolingual method was influenced by behaviorism, B.F. Skinner's behaviorism, and structuralism. Is it okay?
Yes, sir.
And you know, it was a modification of which method? A method was modified?
Direct method.
The direct method. How can you say that it is related to the direct method? Because in it,
we are using the same language.
We are using the target language. We are using the same language. What is the medium instruction? The target language is the medium instruction. Do you use the mother tongue here in this method?
No, sir.
No, medium, mother tongue has no scope.